Father, we just love you this morning. And God, I know sometimes it is hard to clear our minds and to get all the junk out of our minds and all of our failures and what we're dealing with and the losses that we've had in our life, God. But Father, I ask for your grace this morning in each of our lives, your strength in our lives, God, to lay everything aside and focus on you, God. And Father, as we praise you, God, just give us answers to problems that we have. God, just drop wisdom in our hearts and knowledge and understanding, God, and how to deal with different issues in our life, God. Father, as we praise you this morning, God, help us get a revelation of just how big you are compared to our problems, God. And Father, we ask for your anointing in our church services today. God, we ask for your grace to be great in each leader, God. And Father, we ask for the gifts of the Holy Spirit to operate. Father, we love you. And Holy Spirit, we do welcome you here today. In Christ's name, amen.
Hallelujah. Why don't y'all stand? Come on, let's stand and give the Lord a hand clap of praise. How many of y'all come to worship this morning? Just enjoy yourself. Amen. I tell you what you got to do. I'm telling you, if you're going to be a worshiper, you got to learn to shake off all the junk and put a little bit of focus on him for a few moments. Amen. Y'all ready to do it?
I come to worship as I should. Everything you've done has done me good. My mind's made up, my heart's ready too, and I can't wait to worship you. And I can't wait anymore. I can't wait to worship the Lord. Body to sing, body to shout, trees would cheer and the rocks cry out.
Show.
You did. You rescued me. became my king forever. With a crown of thorns, you became my king forever. With a crown of thorns, you became my king forever. With a crown of thorns, you became my king forever. Give you glory, glory. Give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. Jesus, I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. Jesus, I give you glory, glory. Give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. Jesus. Lord, you're so worthy. Hallelujah. Jesus. Nobody like you. We lift you up in this place. Hallelujah, Lord. Glory to your name. Worship you in this place because you're worthy, Lord. I saw the Lord, He was high and lifted up, and His glory filled the earth. His face shone and the glory that fell on me, yes, was the glory that set me free. And angels cry, holy is the Lord, seated on the praises of His peace. of the world. and His glory fill the earth, and His face shone like the sun.
You're the cup that won't run dry.
My Jesus. Jesus, you're the cup that won't run dry. I'm so thankful, love. Jesus, you're the cup that won't run dry. Your presence is heaven to me.
You do.
bless you, Father. Right there where you are, why don't you just honor the Lord a little bit? However you do it, just honor Him for a moment. Speak to Him. Declare, like we talked about last week, declare to Him what He's all about. Hallelujah. We bless you, Father. We bless you, God. God, we thank you for being our strength, our very present help in a time of trouble. Father, we thank you that you're a God that we can call on and you hear us. In fact, I'm reminded that your scripture says your arm's not too short, nor your ear too heavy that it can't hear, oh God. We bless you, God. We bless you, Father. Quickly, I just feel like the Lord says, don't take too lightly His presence. You know what I'm saying? Don't take too lightly Him dwelling within us and living within us. I think sometimes we're more focused on the things of the world. Imagine Him showing up and being here with us, and we just kind of nonchalantly move on from His presence. It'd be like maybe you're a wife or somebody coming into the room and you're not even honoring them and acknowledging them, and you're just kind of going on. We don't want to do that. Amen. We want to acknowledge who He is and love Him and worship Him. Amen. And love Him and honor Him for what He's done for us. He has provided a great salvation for us. It really don't matter what goes on in the world around us, because He is going to take care of you and protect you and work with you through every circumstance. And that's what kind of God we got. Even though He looks at the nations, He cares about you individually. So in the midst of this congregation, you know, all of us are worshiping, but know that He cares about you individually. He's ready to make a move in your life individually. Amen. Lord, we bless you, and we're just grateful that even though you hear the cries of the multitudes, Lord, you can also hear the cry of the one that's pushing in and touching the hem of your garment. We love you and we bless you in this place. We love you and we bless you in this place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
When we were singing that song and it was talking about you rescued me, and I can't, and you say you saved me, you rescued me, My heart goes straight back every time I say something like that. A lot of people think, oh, well, He rescued you when you got saved, or He rescued you whenever, you know, you come to know the Lord. But He rescued me, a born-again child of God. He rescued me. I was going down with migraine headaches. I was literally going down. And He rescued me. And when I think about that song, I don't know about you, if you have nothing that you can say that God rescued you from, then you need to start asking Him, Lord, show me, because He wants to be that God for you. Just like me, when I sing that song, I think you rescued me. I've never been the same again. You healed me. If you don't know Him in that capacity, or you
you can't say that God's ever been your rescuer, even as a born-again child of God, then I urge you, seek Him in that way. He wants to rescue you from he wants to heal you, and if He wants to rescue you in every area of your life, and He's just my rescuer. I don't know. I've been healed of migraine headaches. This October will be 3 years. And I literally thought I was going to die. I mean, that's how bad they were. And God is so good. He rescued me.
Hallelujah. That's exactly right. You know, and what was pretty amazing was I'd have to pick her up and carry her to the doctor, and even in the doctor's office, be throwing up because of the migraine headaches were so bad. And we were just in a little country church in Arkansas after vacation. We just stopped at a little country church, and we weren't doing anything special. We were just worshiping the Lord. Let me tell you something. You got to learn to worship the Lord. It don't matter what kind of music. If they're playing the banjo and yodeling for Jesus, you need to learn to worship the Lord. And that's what we were doing. They were just a little country church, and we were just sitting there worshiping, and a migraine come on her. And she just began to cry out to the Lord, you know. And I really didn't know all this was going on. She told me later. And she just said, God, she's cried out many times before. But this time she cried out and God done it. So I don't know how many times sometimes we got to cry out. But God can do it mightily in the name of the Lord. Amen. He can touch you and heal your body. In Christ's name we pray.
Hey,
yes.
Real quick, if you don't mind. Y'all, while we were doing worship, a scripture came to my mind, and then Brandy came up and confirmed.
You may be seated,
that
by the way.
That was the one that I was supposed to read to you. It's going to be Romans chapter 8, starting with verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. And then we're going to skip over to verse 10. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of Him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, He that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by His Spirit that dwelleth in you. Amen.
That's right. Hallelujah.
Here we go. At our church, Jesus is Lord. That single belief calls us together as a community and sends us into our world with hope and purpose. At our church, your past will never define your future. There's always redemption, which means there's always a brighter day. At our church, we don't think we're better than any other church out there. We're just doing our best to become our best. At our church, we want you to believe in God, but we also want you to know that God believes in you. We are not against people who don't attend church anywhere. Instead, we pursue them with love, the very same love that's pursuing us. At our church, we're learning to serve God with all our hearts, and we're learning to worship Him with all our lives. And if you're looking for the perfect church, we're not it. At our church, we will make mistakes, but we will choose to grow from them. At our church, we're part of a global community that's knit together by the resurrection of Jesus. And by the way, at our church, we believe that really happened too. At our church, we will engage with people who are in real need because we are the hands and the feet of Christ. And finally, we need you to hear this loud and clear. At our church, it's not really our church at all. It's His. And we live and move and breathe in His church for His glory and His fame, not ours. So here's the invitation. You're invited to jump in with your whole heart at your own pace and to experience the life that awaits you in Christ. Friends, this is going to be good. Welcome to our church.
Again, welcome to our church. What you just heard is exactly what we believe here at Hosanna. So if you're a first-time visitor, our prayer is that today you will experience Christ in a way that you've never had before. We want to thank you for being here with us today. And right after services, if you'll go out to the information booth in the front foyer, we have a special gift just for you. Here at Hosanna, we feel that life groups are the source for getting connected and making you feel a part of the Hosanna Church family. Right now, we want to introduce you to Miss Liz Jones, who's going to tell you a little bit about her life group.
Hi, I'm Liz Jones, and I'm so pleased that I'm a part of the Hosanna family here. You know, I've been a part of the Hosanna family for about 3.5 years now, and wow, it keeps getting better and better. But I got a question for you today. Are you single? Are you single because you just haven't found Mr. or Mrs. Right yet? Or are you single because of a divorce, whether it was your choice or not? Or are you single because perhaps your loved one has passed on to be with the Lord? No matter the reason that brought you into your singlehood, I want you to know that we have a place for you. Yes, we have a place for the singles at Hosanna Worship Center. And you can find us every Wednesday night in the old nursery located down the hall from the old toddler room. And we want you to know that there's an exciting group of men and women who are ready to share their hearts with you as we dive into God's Word. Sometimes we go from a book in the Bible, and right now we're using a particular book called Soul Detox. But no matter what we're studying, we're going to be hitting on something that will make a difference to you as a single woman or man. And you know, sometimes married folks just don't get it. And you need to be with someone who understands what you're going through as a single person. You may be single with children or single without. No matter, you'll find a friend on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock at the singles meeting. I'll see you there.
For the last several weeks, we've been asking for your support in replenishing the Children's Church supplies. How you do this is by taking one or more tags off the supply cart found in the front foyer and purchasing those items on the tags and placing your purchases back on the cart the following Sunday. We still have a few items left to be purchased, so please help us out.
We are so excited about our second annual God's Amazing Grace Women's Conference. Our theme for this year is If the Sun Sets You Free, You Will Be Free Indeed. The day will be September 18th and 19th, starting Friday night at 7, doors open at 6. Saturday will start at 1 and go until 5 with doors opening at 12. This year's goal is for women to get together to have a fun and relaxing weekend while growing spiritually and making new friends. Our prayer is for the zeal of God to be birthed in a new and exciting way in everyone's lives that attend, so as to seal the belief that transformations can happen in their lives and the lives of others through Jesus Christ and His Word. We are going to have some great speakers this year who I believe will bring their testimonies and the Word of God in such a way that will stir us up to see that if God can bring freedom to them, then He can and will move mountains in our situations if we surrender our burdens to Him.
We are looking for volunteers to help. If anyone feels the lead to sign up, please do so. You may pick up a registration form and a detailed flyer at the bookstore and at any offering box. Early registration is $15, $20 at the door. We also have t-shirts for sale by pre-order only. We will not be ordering any extras this year, so make sure to order your t-shirt and pre-register by September the 6th. Also, we will offer child care again this year for a small fee to pay our caregivers.
Hey Hosanna, back by popular demand, Tracy Williams is starting back up his Foundation of Faith class on Sunday, September the 6th at 9:30 a.m. Whether you're a new Christian or just feel you need a refresher course in the foundations of Christian principles found in Hebrews, make plans to attend this class. They will be meeting in the old nursery right next to the kitchen. Right now, here are the Children's Ministry and Media Department schedules for this coming week. For the Children's Ministry, check-in kiosk, Wednesday, September the 2nd, Brandy Heidelberg. Sunday, September the 6th, Deborah Lee and Tanita Summers. Wednesday nursery, Lydia Robinson and Nancy Lebo. Sunday nursery, Christy Long and Deja Spearman. Dancing Ants, Annette Pearson and Olivia Williams. Little Leapers, Liz Wilkes and Katie Caldwell. Next Sunday will be Family Day, so there will be no kids out loud next Sunday. All school-aged children will be in the sanctuary with their parents. For the media ministry, Ken Barthol will be directing, Elizabeth Hardzog on video streaming, Eva Covington, Marilyn Jackson, and Willie Lee on cameras, Joseph Beard on front of house sound, Danny McKinney on audio for video, and Jason Long on iMag. We want to wish a happy birthday to Samantha Rutherford on September the 1st. And congratulations to Larry and Marette Mills on their wedding anniversary, September the 5th. Right now it's time for a message from our pastor, Brother Damon.
Linda Wilkes, Bruce Wilkes' wife, is having a little bit of trouble right now, so why don't we just get a phone call? How many of y'all want to, let's see, gather. Why don't you grab somebody's hand next to you, and let's just agree together. Father, your word says where two or three of us are gathered together in your name, that you're in our midst, and that whatsoever we ask of our Father, which is in heaven, Lord God, you hear us. So, Father, we pray right now, whatever difficulties, whatever situations going on in Linda's life, we just speak healing to them, speak healing to the body, Lord God. I thank you that you're going to give doctors the wisdom that they need to correct whatever situation is going on. Jesus, we trust in you. We love you, and we understand that you are a great healer, Lord God. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Good to have everybody here. If you are a first-time visitor, would you lift up your hand like this and let me see you? Oh, you ain't a first-time visitor. Anybody here, see right here? God bless you. Great having you all. Anybody else? Good deal. Right after service in the front foyer, we have a gift there for you, and we would like for you to go pick it up. Good having you here, and we pray that you're blessed abundantly in Christ's name. Amen. If you have your Bibles, let's turn real quickly. I'm going to be late. Just have your Bibles out, because we're going to go over real quickly what we learned a little bit last week, and then we're going to go in and start talking a little bit more about worship, words and worship. You know, words are a big deal. You know it? What we say, what we do, words are a big deal. Words can ring in people's brain for years. What people think and words that we've said or even said about us can ring in our ears for years. And Proverbs 10:11, just a real quick recap over last week. Proverbs 10:11 says, "The mouth of the righteous is a well of life, but violence covers the mouth of the wicked." And we found out that the word well there means a source of life, a source of giving life out. So the mouth of the righteous can either bring life or it can bring death into people. And we talked a little bit about some words that can kind of change your whole life. We use the word marry me, how when somebody asks you for the first time, will you marry me, how that can change your situation. Or when somebody can, when you find out you're with a child and you find out that it's a girl, things just change. Or it's a boy, things change. We've seen and we talked to different people, the very word "you have cancer" can really just mess with people's mind and people's brains. Words like "we lost them." Words like "you're hired." Words like "you're fired." Words like "we won." "We lost." "Guilty." "Not guilty." All the different words. Words have powers and words have meanings. Proverbs 18:21 says it like this: "Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat of its fruit." In other words, what you speak and what you say can bring life and death, can bring good fruit in your life, or it can bring bad fruit into your life. Matthew 12:34-35 says it like this: "Brood of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks." I was taught when I first got saved from my youth pastor that worship and praise is an outward confession of an inward condition. In other words, praise and worship, if you don't find yourself saying much to God, that means because there may not be very much in you. Now, don't get offended, because that says right there, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So praise and worship is an outward confession of an inward condition within the heart and mind. Okay? You ain't got to get offended. It's what Scripture says. You know, you ain't got to get bothered. Just hang in there and see what the Scripture says and allow the Scripture to challenge you. Romans 10:8-11 says it like this: "But what does it say? The word is near you, even in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved." And y'all know as well as I know, the word "saved" does not just mean saved from heaven and hell. Saved there means to be saved, delivered, set free, to be made whole. So it's not just not going to hell and going to heaven. Some of you are dealing with certain issues, and God, all with your mouth and with your heart together, you can begin to see your life change, circumstances in your life change. But be very, very careful for how and what you believe. Amen. So realizing the power of words coupled together with declaring who God is, we want to enter into worship this morning. We want to discuss what worship is about. Let's look at it and see if we can't come up with some good understanding. What does worship look like or sound like? I know in the American church, the church in America, we have defined what we think worship is, and when it don't go quite the way we think in our mind what worship should be, we walk out of the service, that was a good service or that was a bad service. But can you look at an individual and tell them whether if they're worshiping or not? What does worship look like? How do you know when a person is worshiping or not worshiping? Imagine with me some of the Old Testament people walking out of the temple after praise and worship or after the worship service. It probably went something like this. Man, that service was awesome today. I can imagine some of them saying something like, I just don't know if I can worship all those new psalms that Asaph is trying to teach or David's teaching. You know what? Every time I go there, it seems like the psalmist David's always introducing a new psalm. And I just can't get into that. Another one cheers them. Yeah, man, and them loud-sounding cymbals are just too loud. And them trumpets, did you hear the trumpets this morning? I couldn't even worship because the trumpets were so loud. And you imagine that going on? Somehow we've dissected worship and made worship out to be whatever our preference is. If our preference is this particular style, we think that that is somehow worship. And let me tell you something. Worship is not your preference. Worship is not even your cultural style. Worship is something that comes from the heart under God. I said again, I led worship for nearly 20 years. And I can just tell you the plain out fact, it doesn't matter if I'm walking into a Southern Baptist church, all they got is an organ and piano, when worship and praise is going on, my God is worthy of it, whether I like the style or not. In fact, I think it's very arrogant of an individual and very arrogant of the young people today that said, I just can't worship to that kind of stuff. Oh, really? Pretty arrogant. Worship isn't about you. Worship is about God. And somehow we've created the meaning of worship to be our culture or what the style of music we like. And that has nothing to do with worship. The word worship in the Old Testament, and again, if words mean something, if words mean something, then what God's word said should mean something to us, right? Brother Damon's not trying to define something and make you do it. We're simply going to the word of God, and we're going to see today, we're going to use the very first time the word worship is used, the law of first reference, and we want to look at it and just see what it's at. I'm not defining this. It's what God's word said. The word worship means to bow down, to prostrate oneself in honor. That's not Damon's definition. That's what the word of God says. And if we believe words matter and God's word tells us over and over that words matter, then we need to put what God values, we need to value what God's word says. And the word worship means to bow down, to prostrate oneself in honor. How long has it been since you have prostrated yourself before the Lord and chose to honor the Lord for what He's done for you? How long has it been since you've humbled yourself enough to recognize that He is God and you're not? Acts 10:25 says something like this. As Peter was coming in, now this is New Testament. This is after the Old Testament. This is New Testament. This is after the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. As Peter was coming in, Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshiped him. But Peter lifted him up, saying, stand up, I myself am also a man. Even in the New Testament there, they knew to worship was to fall down. And Peter knew that worship was due to the Lord God Almighty. And that's how come he told him to stand up. I'm just a man. But when it comes to loving the Lord and worshiping the Lord, there is a bowing down, mainly in the reverence of your heart, and acknowledging who he is and who you're not. Revelations 22, 8 through 10 says it like this. Now I, John, saw and heard these things. And when I heard and saw, I fell down and worshiped before the feet of the angel who showed me these things. And then he said unto me, see that you do not do that, for I am a fellow servant and of your brethren the prophets, and those who keep the words of this book. Worship God. In other words, look at him. He come in, fell down, and began to worship, and the angel of the Lord said, man, get up. I'm a fellow servant like you. Worship is due to God and not man. That's why I do not like anybody to call me reverend. My title is not reverend. My title is Brother Damon Plummer, because I'm a brother like you. I'm to be reverend no more than just being a normal man. God is the one that we reverend, and we show more reverence to people than we do God. I mean, we'll get around somebody that's big time, and we'll tuck our shirt in, and we'll look nice, and But when it comes to the things of God, we walk in and we arrogantly resist what should be going on in our hearts and mind. Many even refused to bow down and were in prison for it. Daniel chapter 3, 15 through 18 says it like this. Now if you are ready at the time you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the harp, and the lyre, and the psaltery, whatever you call it, in symphony with all kinds of music, and you fall down and worship the image which I have made, good. But if you do not worship, you shall be cast immediately into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. And who is the God who will deliver you from my hands? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If that is the case, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O king. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship. The word worship there means to bow down. We will not worship the golden image which you have set. Look at it, he said, they refused to bow down to something because they knew that worship, where you bow your heart and soul and even sometimes prostrate yourself, worship belongs to God and God alone. See, the ancients recognized that bowing down showed vulnerability and submission. When you bow down to somebody in worship, it shows vulnerability and position. Why? Because your neck was exposed. When a person bowed down to the great lords, when you bow down like this, your neck is exposed, and that is a vulnerable state. Now, that's in the secular world. We don't bow down and expose our neck and call it worship. It was just letting you know, in the old days, buddy, when they bowed down, that was letting you know they are vulnerable to you. They are submitting themselves to you, and they recognize that you are supreme and I am not. But we have a hard time choosing to worship. We have a hard time. Let me tell you something. My kids may not have done everything right, but they ain't going to sit in service and act like a fool. I pop them in the back of the head. Ask them when they were coming up. You honor and worship the Lord. If you can't honor and worship the Lord for an hour and a half, then we got a big issue. I'll take your cell phone. You've heard it. I'll take your cat. I'll take your car. I'll take everything. If you can't take a few minutes to learn to honor the Lord instead of honoring yourself, then we got some issues out of order. Now they're grown and married. I can't do that. But I got grandkids coming up. With all this in mind, we see that worship is the spirit and expression of bowing down before the Lord and paying him honor. You see, you look at people that bow down, you look at them as extremists, don't you? You see people that are extravagant worship, and you look at them like, you're extremists. You ain't got to do all that. Churches that are extravagant worshipers, you criticize them like, you ain't got to do all that. How do you know? How do you know? What does worship look like? How do you know? The only way we know what true worship looks like is according to Scripture. And I just laid out to you that when a man would bow down to another man and say, get up, that type of expression is due only to God and not to man. We just laid it out. But we have a hard time correlating that to us. I want to look at real quickly a portrait of worship, and we won't be long. We'll be about before 12. A portrait of worship. And we want to look at the life of Job real quickly, and let's learn some things about worship. Now, the book of Job is the oldest book of the Bible. A lot of people think Genesis is. The book of Job is the oldest book of the Bible. Most scholars think that Moses wrote it. But we always want to look at what you call the law of first reference. Where's the first time the word worship is used that in the Bible? And we're going to look at that. The first time the word worship is used. And we want to look at the circumstances by which it is. Because this is the deal. This younger generation think worship is this. And I'm not against that. If I wasn't playing the piano, guess what I'd be doing? But that ain't necessarily worship, because you can be doing that and have your heart somewhere else. We have created worship out of stuff that's incorrect. We want to look at the root of what worship is, and we want to submit ourselves to the root of what worship is, don't you? Really, don't you? If God says you, if God's word told us to stand on one leg and yodel Jesus, we should be willing to do it, which he doesn't, but we should be willing to do it, right? Because God knows best. If you have your Bibles, turn to Job chapter 1. I hope I've laid a foundation enough to show you that worship means bowing down before the Lord. And at the very least, is submitting your heart and mind to the Lord. Whatever you think, I submit it to the Lord. Job chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. There was a man in the land of Uz, I guess that's how you pronounce it, whose name was Job. And that man was blameless and upright, and one who feared God and shunned evil. And seven sons and three daughters were born to him. Also his possessions were 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 female donkeys, and a very large household, so that this man was the greatest of all the people of the East. And the sons would go and feast in their house, each on his appointed day, and would send and invite his sisters to eat and drink with them. So it was, when the days of feasting had run their course, that Job would send and sanctify them. He would rise up early in the morning and offer burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, it may be that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus Job did regularly. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Help us. Lord, I don't want to put people on edge. Maybe through harsh words. But God, I don't want us to leave here today not understanding what worship's about. At least giving a person a mental picture where they can choose to make a choice to worship or not worship you. We love you. We honor you, God. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Job was a symbol of great wealth, success, and influence. I mean, he had it. It's kind of like he had the Midas touch. Everything he touched turned to gold, you could say. Not only that he was a successful man, he was a godly man, a man of integrity. You don't find that much anymore, do you? a very wealthy person, a person that had a little bit of everything, but he was a godly man, and he was a person of integrity. Not only was he a godly man, a successful man, a person of integrity, he was a man that all society looked on. In fact, the scripture says he was the most wealthy of all the people of his time. Society looked up to him as somebody that they wanted to for their life to follow after. That, if, in other words, in that community, they said, man, I want to be like that person. Because not only is he wealthy, he is godly and a person of integrity, and that is just exactly what I want to be like. He's a man that loved his family. Think about it. I know sometimes in the middle of the night you lay down and say, Lord, just bless my kids. I hope they don't get too drunk tonight and do anything stupid. But this man did it every morning and every evening. Every morning he went, got up, and he said, my sons may have and my daughters may have accidentally cursed you. And Lord, I want to do a sacrifice for them. And he did it every morning and he did it every evening. Y'all hang with me. And in the midst of that, something happened. If you don't have a good, clear understanding of what worship is, if you think your worship is twisting the hand of God, you're making it about you and not about Him. And we've done that today. We said stuff like, as we worship, our hands go up and the glory comes down. Worship is not about you. It is about the Lord God Almighty. Job chapter 1 verse 13 says, now there was a day when the sons and the daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house, and a messenger came to Job and said, the oxen were plowing and the donkeys feeding beside them. And when the Sabians raised them and took them away, and indeed they have killed the servants with the edge of the sword, and I alone have escaped to tell you. And he no sooner than he got that out of his mouth. Now we're talking about a godly man. We're talking about a successful man. We're talking a man that loved his children. And we're talking about a man who honored God. No sooner than he gets out of his mouth, while he was still speaking, another also came and said, the fire of God fell from heaven and burned up the sheep and the servants and consumed them. And I alone have escaped to tell you. And it wasn't no more that he got that out of his mouth than he looked up and here comes another person running. While he was still speaking, another also came and said, the Chaldeans formed three bands, raided the camels and took them away. Yes, and killed the servants with the edge of the sword. And I alone escaped to tell you. While he was still talking, another one came and said, your sons and daughters, and this would tear my life out, were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house, and suddenly there came a great wind and came from across the wilderness and struck four corners of the house, and it fell on the young people, and they are dead, and I have escaped to tell you. Look at his response now. Then Job arose, tore his robe, shaved his head, and he fell to the ground and worshiped. And he said, naked I came in from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return there. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job did not sin nor charge God with wrong. Let me tell you something. Job ain't no, it wasn't no little fairy tale you're reading here. When you read of it, don't think it's some type of fairy tale. Worship ain't something happened because the music's on cool. Worship ain't something that takes place because there's anointing on whoever's singing. Worship is about a situation that goes on in your heart that will choose to worship in the good times and it's the bad times. It's something that goes on in your heart whether things are going your way or they're not going your way. Job was a real man in a real crisis. He went from being Bill Gates to an emblem of affliction in a matter of moments. And he still made a choice to worship. He went from being successful to be blessed, a man of integrity. And within just a short moment of time, he had absolutely nothing. And he still chose to worship the Lord. That is not the type of worship that we see in America today. We only worship when we think it's okay. And when we want to get out of jail or God deliver me from these drugs, instead of learning to worship through the good and the bad times. He didn't have the problem. He didn't have the prophets of the Bible to encourage him. This is the first book of the Bible. He didn't have the prophets saying the God will shall deliver you. He didn't have that. He didn't have the testimonies of David in the book of Psalms. That surely I shall hide you under the shadow of my wings. He didn't have none of that. He didn't have the encouragement of the New Testament that said, if God be for you, who can be against you? He didn't have any of that stuff. He didn't have a band playing his style of music to jump on the scene and play his style of music while he was in mourning. Job gives us a snapshot of what worship's about. Young people, you live in a crazy world. You live in a world that's false. It's a facade. It ain't real. Mainly you young ones, it's not real. What you see is really not who they are. And one day you get to be about 28 to 30 or maybe older for some, and you begin to realize, this has all been a crazy ride. They told us in the 80s, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, and Brother D filled everything I had with it. It's been a lie. God created us to be an individual. There's just something inherent about us. You can go to the deepest tribes of the world. You can go to the deepest Congo. You can go way into South America, deep down in there, and they're worshiping something. There's something about us that chooses. There's something in us that said, there's a great need in me to submit myself to something, to bow down to something that is greater than I. You go back. Go as far as you can in the jungles, and they're worshiping something. They're paying homage. They're bowing down to something to worship. Number one, worship has nothing to do with our circumstances. You hear me? Worship, you choosing to worship God has absolutely nothing to do with your circumstance. That is the biggest lie that TV preachers have put on you. They've said if you can give a little bit of money, you can praise your way into victory. Now, sometimes life is just tough, and sometimes you got to choose to worship in the midst of it. See, that's... Listen to me. That is something that religious talk can do for you. But be a pastor that has to walk into a room and tell them, well, pull a plug or not pull a plug. You tell them that. You walk into a room that a young girl's had an aneurysm. They call her. They think she's going to die. The doctor tells you she ain't going to make it. And you sit in the room with the mothers and fathers and try to bring some comfort in that. See, have you come to a place in your life where you would choose to worship in spite of your circumstances? In spite of a divorce? In spite of financial ruin? In spite of betrayal? Will you choose to worship? Will you choose to say, God, I don't know, understand all this, but I know you're God. And I'm not. And I will worship you and I'll bow down to you and I'll let you know that everything's going to be okay through you. See, he hated what God was allowing, but still chose to bow down and show his neck. He still chose to bow down and show that you're God and I'm going to worship you in the midst of it. Is your world spinning out of control? Right now in this room, if God's people would just learn to worship, God would send individuals up in our midst that look at people and say, man, that's what I want. If your world's spinning out of control, can you imagine? Man, something just come and got all the camels, and while he was still talking, somebody come up and said, they got your children too? If your world's spinning out of control, worship. Not because it'll do anything necessarily for you, because like Job, he's worthy and he knows what's going on. Because believe me, you're going to have good church folks like Job's wife that says, why don't you curse God and die? What a wife. I mean, there were her children too. Next chapter, chapter 2. Basically, stop whining, Job. Why don't you go on and curse God? And God said, Job said, I ain't cursing my God. See, number 2, real worship proclaims real truth. I have yet to stand and do a funeral. I'm not saying I won't. I just haven't yet. To stand up and do a funeral and say, God, la, 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 la. Man, you got folks that are hurting. They're wondering why mama's gone. They're wondering why daddy's gone. They're wondering why the husband's gone. And I'm not going to stand up there loftily and say all this crazy stuff. I'm going to tell him, you know what? Spill your guts out. Talk to God, because that's exactly what Job bowed down and worshiped and said, my Lord, God, you have truly given me. And Lord, you have ripped my heart out and you have taken away. See, real worship talks to God in a real tone. A real worship gets real with God and discusses the issues with God instead of this false religious bit. Real worship gets real and says, I don't know and I don't understand, but you know what? You are God and God alone. And if they take everything I got, they take everything, I will still worship and bow down to you. There's been times when the finances have been so tight here. I told baby, if we had to, we'll sell everything we got and move into my office. And I mean that. What am I going to do? I cannot believe God's doing this. Or why don't we just yell and scream at the people? Doggone y'all. No, you know what I'll do? I will trust. I'm not going to sing, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take. We sing that, but we don't mean it. That's coming from the book of Job there. Lord, you have given and you have taken away, and I will bless your name in the midst of this. Real words, real talk. God, it's hard for me to worship you when my dad's gone or my mama's left me. And it's hard to worship you in the midst of all the junk that's went on in my life. It's hard for me to worship when I look around and everybody else just seems so normal and my life just seems so crazy. Worship. See, sometimes the truth spells out the cold, hard facts of what really is reality, don't it? Cold, hard facts. Have you sent your $100 in and it didn't work out? Not dogging on it. I thank God for your faith. So this is not Brother Damon jamming on you. Have you let 25 preachers lay hands on you and it didn't work out for you?
learn to go to the Lord. It's not in a preacher. See, my job is to do nothing but try to encourage your faith. But your faith has got to be rest in the man of God, the person of God. I want to do that. Man, if I could spin around like that and you say, man, I love Jesus, guess what I'd be doing all the time? Ow! But it ain't about that. It's somehow me letting you know that it's in the person of God. Learn to worship him in the midst of those things. And God, somehow in the midst of all of this, just don't curse him. Talk to him, discuss it, tell him you don't understand why all this worked out. All I was wanting to do is do your will, and this world's went slap crazy. You just worship. Choose to worship. Job 2, 9 through 10 says it like this. Then his wife said to him, do you still hold fast to your integrity? What a woman. Done lost everything. Yeah, I tell you what. What good is it you've been serving the Lord? What good is you've been doing all that bow down stuff? You've been worshiping, bowing down. Look what she's saying to him. Do you still hope? That's what this society's saying. This society's looking on a group of people who love Jesus and still worshiping. And one day there's going to be a payday, and I believe it's going to happen soon. And baby, everybody's going to be the same. The poor and the rich alike, we're all going to be the same. We're going to be bowing down to Jesus, recognizing he is the one that's going to get us through this circumstance. Then his wife said to him, do you still hold fast to your integrity? Curse God and die. But he said to her, you speak as one of the foolish women speak. Shall we indeed accept the good from God and also not accept adversity? In all this, Job did not sin. What? Look at that. With his lips, his mouth. Listen to me. I want you to be blessed. Jesus died for you to be blessed. But in the midst of that journey, in the midst of you becoming everything God wants you to be, you got to take the good with the bad sometimes. You got to look at an eighth grader and say, darling, you're just not quite good enough to be on the varsity yet. You're not quite good enough to start yet. One of my young girls that go to this church, she didn't bat too well the other day. And I pulled her out, not to be mean, just to help her to think a little bit. Life ain't always easy. Life is tough. Will you choose to worship in the midst of it? Last point. Well, let me read another scripture right here. Can I read another scripture? We're talking about worshiping in affliction. Habakkuk 3, and this ain't, some of you like, this ain't what I come to church for. I want you to tell me everything's going to be all right and I'm going to be a millionaire next week. Look at Habakkuk 3, 17 through 18 says, though the fig tree may not blossom, nor fruit on the vines, though the labor of the olive may fail, and the fields yield no food, though the flocks may be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stall, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. Acts 16, 23 through 27 says, and when they had laid many stripes upon them, they threw them into prison, commanding the jailer to keep them securely. Have received such a charge, he put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks. This is to the disciples. But at midnight, Paul and Silas began to praise the Lord. And I will praise the Lord no matter what tomorrow brings or what it has in store. You know I will praise the Lord These may be shackles. These may be chains. But still I'm free to praise his name. Look at what he said. Suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were open, and everyone's chains were loosed. Now you would have got on out of there. But guess what Paul did? He stopped and seen the jailer getting ready to kill himself. You would have said, yeah, get it, boy, because I'm out of here. Kill yourself. I'm out of here. That's what you get for locking me up. You know you would. I would be tempted to say that. And I might would even say it. I hope I wouldn't. But you know what Paul did? Paul stopped and he recognized him getting locked in prison and even getting scourged and put down was an opportunity. Amen. And he said, you and your household, don't do that. You and your household shall be saved. See, if we will learn to handle our afflictions and our hard time correctly and choose to worship, God will take your circumstances in life and turn around for the good. We, unlike Job, had that promise. He said, hey, take all things will work out for the good of them who love God and who are the called according to his purpose. Last point. Worship is not about us or for us. Let me read that again. Worship isn't about us or for us. Worship is not a spiritual morphine like some people have made. And I love you. Listen, I love you. I'm just going to be truthful with you. Brother D loves you, okay? But I've seen people, boy, we're going over here to worship, and I'm all for it. Don't get me wrong. But worship is something that you do in your heart and mind no matter what. Thank God we can go to places that their music is like we like and we can worship in and we can enter in. But please don't think that worship's about a style or a culture. Know that worship is about that I'm going to worship the Lord through the good times, the bad times, through affliction, through whatever it is. Worship is bowing down and recognizing you're God. I'm not. I don't understand all this, but you're still worthy of worship no matter what in life. No matter what in life. You see, worship is not for us, but for the one we worship is for us. You get that? You see, worship is not for us, but the one we worship is for us. Conclusion. Worship is not nothing to do with our circumstances. Real worship proclaims real truth. Worship isn't about us or for us. The Bible says, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. He's quoting, I think, from Isaiah. There's coming a bowing day one time or the other. It just is. There's coming a bowing day. And if we can't humbly submit ourselves to God in the midst of everything, we're going to find ourselves in big trouble one day when our world's come tumbling down. You say, yeah, your world's going to come tumbling down sooner or later. One of these days, everything that you've trusted in will come tumbling down. Whether it be when you're 90 years old, like the old song says, I've never seen a hearse with a trailer hitch. You can't take it with you when you're gone. There will come a point in time that everything that you get, he said, naked I came into this world, and naked you can't take. There will come a time when you will acknowledge God or hate God. I would encourage you to learn to do it now. Learn to worship now. If you're going through hard times, learn to worship now. Learn to be real with him. Talk it out with him. Finances bad, talk it out with him. Marriage bad, talk it out with him. If your wife is telling you you wish you would die, worship. Heap coals back on her. Me and Brandy have never said we wish each other to die because it would break my heart. But we have thrown pickle juice or something on each other. I'm just real. I love my wife. I watched the end of The Notebook last night. I just cried. Something has me and my wife, I want to climb right up in bed with her and go to sleep and wake up in glory. It would break my heart for my wife to go before me. And can I tell you something? That's the way it is with our God. It breaks his heart when we choose to bow down to things that's not going to bring life. Not that God don't want to bless you with all these things, but learn to honor him with your wealth. Honor him and all these things, and he'll bring you out. Amen. Let's bow our heads. Father, we love you. And I'm going to do a simple altar call. Like Job, is your world spinning? Like Peter, you were walking on the water and then the storms raged. And you would never deny God. He's been too good for you. But your world is spinning. Like my wife said, she was about to give up in a sense, and God met her where she was at, in a little country church in Arkansas. And if you're here and your world's just kind of spinning and you need somebody to just agree with you in prayer, you're going to make it, you're going to come through this, but you just need somebody to agree with you in prayer, why don't you make your way down? And I just want you to kind of stand here in the front right here. Well, just, if you don't mind, just stand there and maybe worship a little bit. Turn the music up and just kind of worship a little bit. We fall down, we lay. Anybody else? Just things are kind of spinning. Just for a moment, worship for me, okay? Okay.